Okay, good morning everybody. Welcome to our computer vision class. I think this is our 7th week, right? So let's continue with our material on edge detection. So actually I'm hoping everybody gets the idea of what we're trying to do here in this class. We're trying to design algorithms to understand the surroundings, visual scenes, right? Visual data. For instance, if I have an image like this, your human visual system can immediately say there are human silhouettes there. Some are standing, one is on a bicycle, for instance, and they are standing next to maybe a bridge. The simplest or the lowest level feature extraction starts with actually detection of edges. Edges are where there is transition from one region, homogeneous region, one object to another object, or background to a foreground figure, as in this one. So last time we've seen some filters where we could actually extract vertical edges and horizontal edges, right? So for instance, if I show you these light to dark or gray transition, I could use an edge filter like this one, right? Similarly, let's see. This is actually my response, right? This is what I would get once I convolve. You guys all know the convolution operation, of course, very well, as you took signal processing. You convolve your filter with the image to get a response where you get, you hope to get a high response around the edges, right? That's the idea. Here is a high response. We've also, here is another, actually, by the way, edge filter. In the edge kernel, this one detects a vertical edge. Again, this one detects a horizontal edge. This time, you see these more central pixels have larger weights, 2, -2. And remember, what was important in an edge filter? The sum typically sums to 0 because we don't want it to give a response at homogeneous regions. Right, but we wanted to give a response where there are transitions between regions. So first -2 to 2, -1 to 1. Actually, of course, there is 0 in between, but that's the transition. You do a convolution if this was for instance, a patch from your image. Yeah, and we've studied this last time also. Do you guys remember why we typically do a little bit filtering here? It's a little bit exaggerated, but it depends on your application. There is a Gaussian blur, and these are averaging type filters, of course, right? Actually, this is the filter kernel for the Gaussian blur, by the way. Z is the field image. Okay, Z is the image, and this is a 5x5, you see, normalized. This is an averaging or Gaussian smoothing filter, actually, takes its coefficients from a Gaussian function. Filtering topic, I think, is quite well understood. And edge detection is also filtering. Some of the feature extraction tasks are also accomplished by filtering. So you see now, again, the contrast between the difference between a smoothing filter and edge filters. Here, remember, we said last time, I filter my image, for instance, a vertical edge filter and a horizontal edge filter. I can square my responses, add them up, and take the square root, which is, of course, the L2 norm. And that gives me, actually, the magnitude of the image gradient. Of course, there is also a direction because it's a 2D vector. I could also create a direction map like this. But typically, we try to look at the gradient magnitude to be able to see these large magnitude regions and then built on top of these. Of course, this is the first very low level understanding or processing of visual data, right? And last time, remember, we've seen our human visual system also works by processing edges, starts by at least. Let me see what else was here. Yeah, linear filtering, you guys now are experts on it. We've talked about the Sobel filter. This is another filter for us. I mean, you can play with the weights. Let's see. For instance, here, yeah, you can come up with different filters. We've seen this last time. Here, the idea, and also some of you asked about the edges in our environments like Python, PyTorch, there are actually options for choosing the resulting output image size. You can say, I want a valid, I just want the valid part of the convolution. In typical image processing, actually, we don't want the image to get smaller because this one tries to just get rid of these border parts where the filter did not fit into the image. So the image gets smaller by minus f plus one. F is the filter size. Same, we typically try to get the same output. So use the same option. So output size is the same as the input size. That's where actually the image is first padded by the half of the filter size. And then we do the filtering on both sides, of course, half of the filter. It's an odd sized filter typically. So it's the minus one over two size padded. Padding P here is F minus one over two. Here then in this course, in this graduate level deep learning course, we go to say now these filter coefficients become learnable and things like that. But of course, it's not our topic. Going back to our edge detection, feature extraction, which is very important, by the way. Again, I repeat, just stepping these parts, low level understanding, or manual feature engineering or manual processing, and just going directly to learning is not wise to machine learning. You have to really understand the basic data science, data processing, okay? So let's now move on to where we were. I think you remember these experiments of this a cognitive scientist, right? Where when we look around, actually, we are also mainly focusing on these contrast changing or edged regions. This is also a compression, right? Trying to get rid of redundant processing, which is really good for efficient processing in our brain. So I think, let's see, last time, we've discussed a little bit motivation for processing edges because human visual system also really first starts by processing edges. So some neurons are really just sensitive to different types of edges. Remember from our first week of the class, we defined different types of edges last time, remember? And then we designed some filters based on the these derivative approximations, numerical approximations of the derivatives, first and second derivatives, remember? And this is all we've been through, this material. So, and I assume you can calculate, for instance, a forward difference, backward difference, centered difference, and a second derivative difference. So you guys know how to do that. We also motivated that, that derivatives are noise sensitive. So we have to do some image smoothing before derivative operation, which is edge detection operation in a way. It's like a derivative taking operation. And image gradient is something we use a lot. We that is based on the two partial derivatives with respect to these horizontal and vertical directions. It gives us a nice and very expressive feature vector, actually, which is you see showing these directions where the edges are actually directed to. I think we've done these. Then we started with edge kernels, different edge kernels or masks, filter masks for an edge detector, you can call them. I think these we've seen like different kinds of edge weights, actually filter weights. I think this is the most simple one. Remember, minus one, zeros, ones, minus one, zeros, ones, again, in different directions.
Similarly, so bell operator, we've seen these filter masks where now I have also these diagonal directions. I'm thinking we were somewhere here last time. I was asking you this, I think, last time, and I remember you guys correctly said we could use the filter W3, for instance, right? These are not oriented towards a diagonal edge, which is shown in this image. So everybody check yourselves whether you can say, you can also, when you see this edge patch from an image, you can really say this W3 would extract that edge. If you filter your patch with this filter here, you could extract, get a high response from the image, right? Okay, yes, this was the last one. Then we say, okay, let's continue with line detection filters. So actually you can come up with different variants of these edge or contrast change detectors in your image. The goal is when you are actually creating these masks, your target is that the maximum response of this filtered result should occur at those desired locations. For instance, here, if this is the image, look at the bottom right, there are, you see white lines, right, on a dark background. Here, the question is, which filter mask will give the maximum response and help you detect the lines in this image? So let's check. I've already said the in the text here, but this is, you see, a filter oriented in a 45 degrees. This is a horizontal filter. Horizontal, this is really like a, more like a line detector. I could have had zero here, but now you see this time, these lines are supposed to be places where the contrast change happens, and then another contrast change happens. So for instance, if it's a white line or lighter line like structure, contrast increase a little bit constant and then a decrease like here. That's why this filter you see is this time not like exactly the first Sobel edge detector in a horizontal direction, but it puts two at the center because it's trying to exaggerate the line response. Of course, if these were, for instance, dark lines on a white background, you have to invert these filters, right? They should be the other way around. I should have a minus two here and plus ones at the two sides. Okay, so this would be detecting, for instance, diagonal line, this second one. This would detect a vertical line, and this is a diagonal line this time in the other direction, okay? Horizontal filter, exactly. So for instance, if I'm given this patch from, I think this looks like maybe a circuit board or some part like that, industrial part, you may be starting some processing, understanding processing, for instance, it could be defect detection, maybe, or like whether the lines are continuously represented. I mean, the material is continuously here soldered, like it continues without breaks or gaps, then you may be after some line-like detection. Of course, here it's a very basic detection, and this is just the beginning for your processing, of course, right? I mean, this is not alone giving you these high-level decisions that you want to do, but again, you start with the low level processing and then move on to this higher level processing, exactly as it happens in our brain. Cognitive processes continue in a hierarchical way. Typically, not typically, one way at least it starts, it's what we call bottom up approach. Okay, so let's see. If I have this time, let's compare what happens when we have noise in the image. This is the original image. This is a version with noise added on top of it. Remember last time we said actually the gradient or any derivative operator gets noisy. So I want to see now if these slides are a little bit displaced. Yes, these could have come earlier. It's fine. So anyways, Gradient magnitude, of course, on the original image, nicely showing edges. On the noisy image, there is a problem. Now, it looks at, these slides look at the response of these different types of edge detectors on original and noisy images and compare. These are all noisy images. Okay, so noisy, because Sobel, remember, had these larger values in close to the center. It may be giving these more noisy looking outputs. This looks quite clean to me on the left. Actually, this could be on the original image. I'm not really sure. Let's look at, these are some from some older slides. So let's look at these, which makes more sense. This is from the book. Let's see. Okay, these are the gradients in X direction, gradients in Y direction. And this is the addition of, you see the L1 norm this time, the absolute value of these two masks. Nicely extracting the edges in this man-made object. It's a building, right? So it's a building. So it has lots of straight edges, actually. So let's see. I'm trying to see what's happening. This must be thresholding here at this point. From here, the edge map to the later final edge result, you may want to threshold and get a binary edge map. If you want to do further processing on this, we will see next, after this slide, feature extraction, we will actually fit line equations, lines, detect lines from these images. Okay. So I think I'm trying to see. Okay, yes, after this, we didn't have more examples there, it's fine. So second derivative based operators, this is Laplacian, based on mainly the Laplacian operator. Probably you recall this from your 101 physics, 101, 102. This Laplacian, we sometimes show it by the triangle actually. Not inverted nabla like this, but the triangle operator. This one, this is nabla squared, by the way. Gradient we show by just this nabla, the inverted triangle. This depends on second order partial derivatives in each direction. If it was a 3D image, I would add, for instance, delta squared by delta z squared. Okay, if you open this up by your numerical methods knowledge, probably, again, something you've seen before, the Laplacian operator gives us this approximation. It's the center pixel, you see, minus its four neighbors. So if you actually just take this four next to your eye, it really gives us this mask. Four in the center, coefficient four, minus ones in its immediate neighborhoods and zeros in the diagonals. This is called the Laplacian operator. Yeah, here is actually the notation I was talking about, delta I or nabla squared I. And we show it also, these guys, by I sub xx plus I sub yy. I mean, this is important to know, this operator. Again, as a computer engineer, Laplacian operator is something in your mathematical tool arsenal, right? It's something you can make use of. Yes, exactly. The mask, this is repeating. It's fine. The coefficient in the mask sum to zero. Let's check it out here. Exactly. Typically sums to zero. Sometimes we try to boost things in the middle. I will show you. For instance, this four will be multiplied by a constant. But typically, we want this sum to be zero. So exactly now inverted, we can invert now this what I wrote before. And of course, depends on really what type of points or edges you are after. So now I can have minus 4, 1, 1, 1. Okay. So let's maybe think of this in a case where I have a white background or actually I have, yeah, it's fine actually. If it's dark background or, and a white dot or white point, it's still fine. I could get a very negative output at that point, or vice versa, I would get a positive output, right? And by the way, we can also include diagonal terms in the mask. Instead of zeros here, now I have ones, but now make the center minus 8 to make it still sum to zero. Okay. Here, because in the end, the result we want for point detection, let's say, at the point location, we want a very negative output. The surroundings will be positive, more positive, so we should get a zero crossings detector. So, for instance, let's say you get your response R by filtering by one of these filters, your image. That gives you an image R, the response. Well, here, actually. This left one is the input image. This is your point detector filter mask. You convolve the two to get this in the middle. Okay. And you actually, let's see. You get this time. You have a threshold when it's greater than T. Let's try to think of this. Minus 8 months because it's much brighter, right? I'm trying to see if there is an inversion here. Ah, we looked at its absolute value. Okay, it's fine. Yes, I didn't see the absolute operator here, but fine. Yeah, it was very negative, but we take the absolute. It's a very much positive, more positive output for this defect. For instance, this is, let's say, a defect detection. Here I see a defect. This would be the easiest way to go after a defective detection, most low level idea. Go take a line or point detector like this, filter your image with it, take the absolute value of this response function and threshold it. Of course, setting this threshold is an open question, but you can, it's a hyperparameter you have to fix. But in the end, your goal would be to get a mask where you have you really mark this artifact by a non-zero value and others with zero. Okay? Is this clear? Let's see. Other Laplacian operators, or again, let's look at the Laplacian operator masks. So this was point. You see, actually, Laplacian operator helped us detect the point. So these were, we said, Laplacian masks for four neighborhoods. Yeah, this is ignoring the diagonals, or eight neighborhood case. Of course, we will be using it's negated, for instance, and then take the absolute value. It's fine. Both ways are fine. Okay. So it's then this mask that we are using, or it's a negative version. We can have different versions of this mask with stressed significance of the stressed central pixel. Let's see. Now you see we have from here to here, I have now immediate neighbors set to minus 2. The center stays at 4. Diagonals are increased to 1 to make the sum. Let's see what is our sum. Yeah, makes it to 0 again, which is good. Okay. Or you can give more significance to the diagonals, which is also fine. Okay. We are following, right? You can, I mean, these are all design issues, guys. I mean, which mask to use? Sometimes you just get your hands dirty, you get convolved with different masks and look at the responses for your data set and try to learn actually those handcrafted filters. Of course, or you can let the machine learning system learn such filters for you. Okay. One property of Laplacian edge derivative is actually, or Laplacian operators is, it's an isotropic filter, meaning it's invariant to rotation. Isotropic filters would then give me the same response when it's applied to an image and when it's applied to its rotated version, which is really a good point. Okay, so that's one advantage. Then it's not used in its original form. We typically need to, especially because it's a second order derivative, it's even more sensitive to noise than the first order derivatives like the gradient operator or other edge detector masks we've seen. Those were mainly, most of them were first order derivative based filters, or inspired at least. The magnitude of the Laplacian produces double edges, remember, because it's the second derivative. We've seen this last time. And it doesn't, by the way, one disadvantage is it's not giving us any edge direction, right? A gradient gives us an edge direction, which is nice. So now we go to more advanced techniques for edge detection. It's actually nothing but, again, using some smoothing plus, for instance, the Laplacian. We will utilize Gaussian function as a pre-filter. And we will hear most important thing is, before we discussed, when we discussed edge operators until here, they have fixed kernel size. For instance, 3x3, 5x5. We've even seen 2x2 filters. But now we will look at these filters at different scales, or in a way, we will be looking at the image at different scales. So that's the goal, is to target different scales, different features at different scales. Okay, then change the size of the operators. Actually, Gaussian variance, its standard deviation, will help us to be able to do that. And this is called multi-scale or multi-resolution processing of images. So small operators will detect sharply focused fine edges. Large operators detect blurry edges, actually. A little bit mathematics here. Laplacian of Gaussian. Remember, we said we know what Laplacian operator is. We know what Gaussian filtering is. Now we will combine the two. We will actually start with a Gaussian function. Okay, here is a Gaussian, right? It's a zero mean and with standard deviation sigma. Now, if you take the Laplacian of this, this is actually second derivative, right? You remember we add the second derivative with respect to x plus second derivative with respect to y. It's a scalar operator, this Laplacian. So that's why you see this is the Laplacian. And then we will be actually filtering the image with this operator. So you see we are adding the smoothing, pre-smoothing on top of the image. So this is also known on top of the edge detection, sorry. Mar-Hildred edge detector. This Mar-Hildred, I think, again, one of the earlier image processing or vision people from, I think, MIT labs in 70s or 80s maybe. Okay, so it's, you see, 50 years ago. Here is the operator, that operator actually, this guy, Laplacian of the Gaussian. It has a nice shape. It's called a Mexican hat, actually. If you, this is in 2D. Of course, our filters are 2D, X, Y. Nice, you see, it has makes a dip, right? Makes a zero crossing and comes back to zero. That's why it's called, you can remember this, like a somewhat like a Mexican hat operator. And you can actually analytically, of course, write or compute, numerically compute this operator and then derive a mask out of it. Okay. This is negative of the LOG, by the way. We typically use negative of the LOG. In the end, we are looking at zero crossings. Depends on also what type of let me see what type of edges. Normally, actually, we should be not be changing this with respect to dark to bright, bright to dark transition. So it should really help us in both types, because our goal is to detect an edge. So where there is an edge, we are hoping there is a double, in this one, there is a double response, right? So that's why I have, you see, a positive, very positive in the center, and I have the negatives around the center. And this is, you see, an isotropic, by the way. I hope you can see how it is rotation invariant this time. So we are not really designing this filter, edge filter, towards any directions. There is no vertical or horizontal edge operator here, right? So let's see. A is three-dimensional. B is, yes, negative of the LOG displayed as an image. LOG is Laplacian of Gaussian. We see the one-dimensional cross-section. And this is the 5-5 mask approximation, of course, to the shape. It's also rounded and nicely designed, inspired by or approximating a Gaussian numerical computation. And the negative of this mask is used. Yeah, negative of. So actually, it's negative in the center and positives in the surrounding. So now we can, by changing the standard deviation of the Gaussian function and sampling it, we can then generate masks at different sizes n by n. And then we add a Laplacian mask on top of it. And of course, the desired property here, the reason we're doing this is Gaussian part blurs the image and reduces noise in our derivative computations, okay? So here is the trick. By the way, okay, this is, let me see. Yeah, you can still see the zero crossing here, but here I think it's not really nicely visible as in this case. The dip is visible here to where it goes to negative, but anyways. Now convolve the LOG filter with input image, we said. Remember, this was the LOG filter convolving our image. And then we get a response, right, J, let's say. And then this response we have to process more. We can have to do zero crossing detection on top of it to determine edges in IXY. So one thing we notice here is, guys, this is a linear operator. Convolution is also linear. This is linear. So we can actually rewrite this as we can move this parentheses in a way to the convolution side. So meaning I can first do the convolution now and then do the Laplacian, since these are linear, both linear operators. Okay, convolution and Laplacian. So you see, we change the order of the two operators, okay? So this is equivalent. Now what we do is exactly what we were proposing before. First smooth the image, then apply the Laplacian, okay? So instead of just directly first applying the this Gaussian of Laplacian, Laplacian of Gaussian operator, okay? So now Laplacian of Gaussian edge detection, or sometimes called Mar-Hildred edge detection, those were the first people to propose it, that's why, or use it. You filter the input image with a given a certain size Gaussian low-pass filter. Of course, this how to choose n and sigma is important here. Then we compute Laplacian of the resulting image using the 3x3 Laplacian mask. Okay, on slide, we have to have a Laplacian mask like this. Okay, or it could have been the original Laplacian mask, actually. Remember, we had, for instance, 4, minus 1, and zeros. And we want to find the zero crossings. So of this response, I think we have it somewhere coming. Now, this shows how to choose sigma, which is the right scale. Actually, the idea is really filtering the image with various sigma. We may not be able to really know what is the appropriate standard deviation that would remove the amount of noise, which is unknown, right, in the field in this image. So here, filter size, you can fix n. Okay, let's say you present a grid of n by n for your filter mask. Here, fixed size, but you can change sigma. So for instance, here, sigma is small, right? Small standard deviation, very sharp filter. It's really focused in the center. So this would be after fine details, right? Now start increasing sigma. It was here 2, standard deviation 2. Now it's 7. You see now it will detect maybe more, a little bit more spread features, a little bit larger. But here, sigma, the standard deviation is 11. This is a very coarse filter. It's really after big features, large features. Okay? One idea is with this, what is also called a scale space approach. You create a space of scales you create all these responses from different sigma, and you combine the results, think zero crossing edge maps, by just fusing them together and looking at or keeping edges that are common to all maps. For instance, this is one idea. So this ties to multi-scale processing of images, and typically exactly sigma keeps increasing. This is really amounting to analyzing the image at different scales by varying the sigma. And in the end, your question is again, how do we combine these results or responses at different scales? We try to detect those features that are persistent across scales. So meaning like an overlap, right? A majority voting in a way. Try to keep those features, okay? The edges that are common to all maps. What is the idea of multi-scale processing of images? So if I show you this image, you would be saying, of course, this is a very simple image example. There is one object, right? There, it could be a more complicated scene where there are multiple objects. That's what I'm saying. But you figure out, looking at this image, there is a silhouette, right? There is a background and there is silhouette of an object, not very clear. But now, for instance, actually, if I were to look at it at a less coarse scale, you would see that there is a tripod-like, right, a structure here with a camera on top of it, right? This is a tripod. Now, I think once we really make it finer, I can see the door at the back, the door handle, and all other features, exactly fine features on this tripod handle, like all these connection parts and legs, and legs even started to be seen here. You see the larger parts, the bulk parts, the handle was seen here, but all the details of the connections and little texture on top are seen on the fine images. So the idea is this, you see, typically, of course, we have a fine image. Hopefully we capture a fine image because we can't really create this from given the blurred image, right? Of course, this is where we start, but we try to go in this direction in order to look at the image at different resolutions in a way. Okay, so sigma really sets the scale at which we try to detect information or preserve information in the convolved image. Okay, and for instance, some structures, important details here are lost in later images. For instance, the details here, especially for instance, look at this door handle and the key parts here, that is all missed, all lost here, almost all, right? Even this feature is almost not visible here, and of course not visible. By the way, of course, I'm skipping some sigma here. It's really with large sigma steps. You could try to get more finer stepping on the sigma parameter, right? So exactly, larger sigma, you remove most of the features. Small sigma, you have lots of features. You would be asking yourself, Dan, why am I removing those features? Because in understanding, cognitive understanding, typically you may be like trying to first get the big picture, right? I mean, just going or drowning yourself in the details may be a problem. That's why also our brain both looks at bottom up, but also there is a top down processing in our brain where there are some world models. For instance, when I see this picture, at least in my mind, even if it's very blurry, I can say there is a tripod looking object there because I know how a tripod looks like, right? Even though I didn't see this picture, if I'm looking at a picture somewhere in between these, maybe this is too exaggerated, the one on the left, but another picture or smoothing level somewhere in between the two, I can still say that's the tripod-like object. Of course, I could be mistaken, but you see, this is top-down processing now. We want to combine the two. That's what our brain does. Low to high, high to low level processing. In our algorithms, we try to combine them, okay? So if a small filter is used, there is like to be also more noise. Exactly. With a small filter, if there is noise, unnecessary features, details here, that will distract us. So with smoothing, we try to get rid of those either. Okay? So for large filters, of course, problem is edges which are close to each other may get merged. But then that's why we do this multi-scale operation where we really try to combine or detect persistent edges, okay? Okay. By the way, there is another approximation to Laplacian of Gaussian, or sometimes people resorted to this. This is difference of Gaussian operator. So you can, you see, you can come up with different edge operators. Now this time, you can create two different Gaussians, okay? For instance, here are two different Gaussians. Let's say this red one is a Gaussian with a small scale Gaussian function. This green one is a Gaussian with a larger scale. So it's this green is after coarser features. This red is after finer features. Take the difference between the two, you get this blue curve. Do you see? And it's in 2D, it's here, visualized in 2D. You see how it looks similar to the Laplacian of Gaussian operator, this inverted Mexican hat, right? And now we can, the nice thing is we can create two Laplacian, two Gaussian masks, okay? One with a larger sigma, sigma one, one with a smaller sigma, and take the difference between the two and create a very similar Laplacian of Gaussian difference mask, okay? So this is also some other operator you can come up with. Let's look at again what we have. And if actually you can analytically show this, if you choose sigma in this way and the amplitude ratio, I think, let me see, 1.75 to 1, meaning the larger sigma is 1.75, the small sigma standard deviation is 1, then people here numerically showed actually they have Laplacian of Gaussian, LOG and DOG will have similar profiles. So that's of course something to know if you want to use difference of Gaussian masks. Okay, I hope these are clear. Any questions until here? Good. Actually, by the way, one nice thing is these Gaussian filters are separable, meaning actually they're, for instance, I can use 1D filters in vertical, horizontal, vertical, or if it's a multi-dimensional image, it can be in different dimensions. I can use 1D filters, meaning first filter horizontally, filter then the result vertically. That's equivalent to, that's a separable filter, equivalent to using already a 2D filter. And you can see it from the form of the exponential actually, right? This is e to the x squared 2 sigma squared times e to the y squared. So it's really, in a way, you can see these two are can be separated from each other. So let's see the number of operations for 1D or separable field. If you do separable operation, which is efficient, which is more advantageous, because if I have a n by n image, filter size is n. If I use two 1D filters, one in horizontal, one in vertical direction, you see my operation size ops is 2n times mn. If I use the 2D mask, it would be n square mn, right? So that's why also if you can work with separable filters, which is really advantageous. Okay, this slide is comparing the LOG and DOG, negatives of Laplacian of Gaussian, which is the solid curve, difference of Gaussian. It's, you see this dashed one here. Actually, you see even with profile of ratio 1.6 to 1, meaning the this one, guys. Exactly. Sigma 1 is 1.6, sigma 2 is 1. Actually, I see that it is even closer to the LOG than the 1.5 to 1 ratio. So I think we should write here 1.6, which is, yes, here it also says 1.6, okay? You can numerically see that you're getting close. Probably when you make it smaller and larger, when you plot this curve, you will see that the agreement between the two curves will get large, less. So you try to stick to that ratio, okay? So let's see. These are, I think, trying to show the Gaussian, its first derivative, second derivative, and then the difference of a Gaussian. Yeah, again, trying to compare, not actually very high resolution visualizations, but the look at here also the contours, iso contours, or here, yeah, it's exactly iso contours, actually. They also look like Gaussian, right? Ellipses. So their contours here also look quite similar. So we can, I think, safely say DOG is a very nice approximator to LOG, okay, operator. Yeah, I mean, scale space operation, the amount of blurring depends on value of sigma. I think we've already talked about this. Although a larger sigma is of course better in giving us less noise, less distractors, but of course then we are losing the edge information. So you have to be careful in choosing the sigma. Let me see here what happens. This was, let me see, the result of LOG or DOG, and we've seen actually they are very close to each other. So this is, let's say, your response, LOG or DOG response. Let me see, this must be a thresholded version of these guys, of this guy, of this response. But when I applied different sigma, okay? So actually I will have multiple R maps, of course, response maps, right? Multiple filtered results with sigma 1, sigma 2, and sigma 4. Let's say it's LOG, because for DOG, I need to set also two sigma, the difference. I set one of them, and then the other is defined by a ratio, remember. So here, the point here in the slide is, as we increase sigma, you see that the edges, positions of edges are actually smeared, diffused. It's not very localized. Well, edges are not well localized. Look at this, in a way, edge map, like looking gradient map maybe, or LOG result of the image. I think this may be the gradient map, by the way, because I'm seeing the features at the correct locations, not with different sigma, or it could be LOG of sigma equals one. Okay, these are some things that you will get, you can get your hands dirty with very easily. Just implement these. There are all these operators already coded, but in this course, if you are asked to do this, of course, you will code them from scratch. Okay, that's the idea of learning, guys. But my point here is, if I use a small sigma, you see my edge localization is good, because if this was, let's say, just even the gradient image, gradient magnitude, my edge locations are quite close to, maybe on top of these correct edge locations in the finest image, right? The fine resolution image. But here, the problem is I have now very many distractors, very much noise in my background. If I try to do a high level processing here, although my edge locations are okay, I would be really much distracted to extract the meaningful information. Maybe I'm just after this silhouette, it would be a problem, right? Or I'm just after the handle, maybe handle of this tripod. So with sigma equals two, I start to get rid of this background noise, or even look at sigma four, I'm really concentrated on the object's main silhouette. But now, of course, my edges are really very coarse, edge locations, right? So the idea is, of course, to be able to combine all these different masks together. Okay, this was the idea of this slide. I think, let me see, again, the same idea is presented here. We have to analyze the behavior of edges at different scales of the filtered results. Okay. So it's trying to say at larger scales, it's robust, meaning less noisy, robust, but displaced or smeared edges. And you can try to connect them. So you see here, it's the blurred end, right? This is a scale space processing of this image. Sigma, increase your sigma, keep blurring your image. This is with Gaussian filter at the top and at the bottom. This is, let's say, I think here it was not LOG, it's just directly the gradient magnitude, but you could also think of this your LOG or DOG results. The idea is the same. Here, you can try to track, you can start processing here, and now because you are after the main features in the image, you can track these edges back to their finer locations by combining these edge maps. But then the goal will be, of course, because I started from the coarser result where the noise was eliminated, I'm not really stuck on these other noise if I started from the fine scale. Do you see what I'm trying to say? Of course, you may argue that, for instance, in this image or in this blurred image, I'm losing details of the fur on the head of this woman, right? This person. So, of course, depends on the task, right? If you are after, for instance, silhouette of the face, the head, and things like that, you are you can say this is good enough. But for further details like the maybe details on the face or on the texture on the head, or maybe if you had clothes, she had clothes, texture on the clothes, then you would have to go back to definitely to the small scale or higher resolution result. Okay. Specify size of the LOG. This is actually, I think I told you this before, for creating the Gaussian filter. You use the fact that from probability, we know 99.7% of the volume under a Gaussian lies between plus minus 3 sigma, right? About the mean. So you typically take n, the size of the filter, as the smallest odd integer greater than or equal to 6 sigma. Then you fix the sigma at each of these scales. Okay. So now this, let's summarize. It's a zero crossing edge filter. Summarize LOG or DOG. Use a 3x3 neighborhood. Okay, here trying to, let me say, no, this is not LOG or DOG. This is trying to say a zero crossing edge detector. Generally, it doesn't have to be 3x3. It could be other larger filters. Probably we should say n by n neighborhood, okay? Just let's replace it by n. Zero crossing, how to detect it? Signs of at least two of its opposing neighboring pixels must be different, the sign. So you look at up, down, and left, right, and also two diagonals, and at least two of them, two of those opposing neighbor should have different signs in the response to this zero crossing edge detector mask, okay? And after that, you need to use a threshold, okay? Not only must the signs differ, but also absolute value of the response, or the which is the numerical difference, must exceed the threshold. Let's look at some LOG results. These are LOG on the original image and the a little bit noisy image. Edges are at the zero crossings. Here, we haven't yet extracted the zero crossings. Let's see, this is showing. No, actually, this is the zero crossings results. It's really very noisy, by the way. So this would show me I would need further coarser scales, right? LOG is not, by the way, very much like the top choice, but mathematically it's very elegant, and you should also know how we can really create these different scales, because the same idea applies to first order derivative filters too. And it has these nice properties of isotropic, being isotropic, and also using these Gaussians at different scales. So for instance, if I used a small scale Gaussian, you see I pick up a lot of noise, with a very large variance, I can clean most of that noise in my Gaussian. And then after that, at the end, you use a threshold, a low versus high threshold, although I see not much difference, but still I can see some of the noise are eliminated at the background here. You see a little bit cleaner here and there. Okay, let's look at some results from the book, textbook. Original image, input image on the top left. Steps of, okay, this is Marr-Hilbert algorithm, sigma equals 4, and you see 25 by 25 filters. Filter size is 25. Now, zero crossings. This looks, you see a little bit low contrast because this is really, you see image intensities were scaled to the range 0-1 because now I have minus plus values here. That's why it looks a little bit vague or not very high contrasty. Now you do a zero crossing, okay, using a threshold of 0. So no magnitude thresholding, actually just do a zero crossing. You see you pick up a lot of unnecessary details and noise. Now zero crossing using a threshold equal to 4% of the maximum value in the image, you get this bottom right image, which is not a bad edge detector, by the way. Actually, LOG, I was telling you, is not great, but actually I should take it back with good tweaking on the parameters. You can get good results. So this completes these filters, the filter mask-based edge detectors. Here is a Kenny edge detector, a more advanced one, again from 80s actually, Kenny, and again from MIT. This MIT AI lab, visual, this was, I don't remember if there was a vision lab, but these people were, many of the scientists were the pioneers of computer vision and image processing. The Kenny edge detector was also from a scientist with last name Kenny. I think in 81, it was proposed in 81. This one is smooths again image with a Gaussian, makes a gradient computation. But after that, there are some further steps. For instance, it looks at the gradient response and does something called non-maxima suppression, meaning looks at the neighboring gradients also and tries to see if this guy is really maxima when compared to its neighbors. So when it has a high response, this pixel, its neighbors in the direction of the edge should have low response. So again, very much inspired from human visual processing. Okay, so let's see. It does this. Filter the image with a Gaussian first. G is a Gaussian filter. This is convolution, remember. Over the response J, the filtered image, compute the image gradient vector. You know how to do it. I won't go over it now because this is from last time we've studied this. You also know how to calculate the gradient angle, of course. M is the gradient magnitude and alpha is the gradient direction. Now, the Kenny adds these further advanced steps, Kenny algorithm. It says, I want to retain this point in my M mask, M, as an edge point if its gradient magnitude is higher than a threshold. This is like before. This is the new part. If its gradient magnitude is a local maxima in the direction of the gradient. So imagine there is an edge in my image and I found a maxima in my M, the gradient magnitude mask. Now I look at, I also calculate the edge gradient as I'm showing here, actually in both directions. It has to have an arrow here too. Now I go to those pixels, step to those pixel locations, look at their M, the mask, the gradient magnitude mask, and try to see if this guy is really a maxima along that direction. You see it as this directional processing, okay? And this is the detail, the just computational details of it. Quantize your alpha, the angles into these actually 8 sectors here. And then because that's where we will be stepping, plus minus 45 actually, plus minus horizontal, plus minus vertical. Actually eight, but it's still really horizontal, vertical and diagonal, but we add there, of course, negative sides too, right? So I have eight directions to consider my m, the magnitude of the gradient. If it's less than at least one of its two neighbors, then it's not really an edge. It can be a spurious response, high response. So if it's greater than, if the magnitude is greater than at least its two neighbors in those eight directions, eight directional neighbors, then we keep it as a edge. That's the idea. The reason I made this steps four and five gray is they are not responsible. You just have to know for this class these three. It's a lot of material to go for edge detection. We've already covered enough. We have to move on to other topics. But you can just take a look. They do connectivity, linking edge points. And if we were to do it, we would have to really spend more time on those. There is a connectivity analysis where it tries to link the edges. It tries to create a smoother, more continuous edge map, actually. And then tries to also thin, localize the edges more, okay? It adds two more thresholds here, parameters, upper and lower thresholds to determine strong and edge strong. And let me see, and its connectivity in the edge thinning step, I think. But this would be, for instance, I'm going to show you better results, but this would be the edge map, Kenny edge map, for that tripod image I've shown you. And after this, for instance, this is the basis for, let's say, the most basic low-level processing of your image, and it's basis for subsequent processing. We will be doing it in this next lecture now, next hour. We will next go to, up on top of the edge detection, go to line detection or ellipse detection, for instance, to find, for instance, industrial objects, okay? More higher level computer vision, still low level though, but so then Kenny results here are compared by different parameters of the Kenny algorithm. Again, this is the variance of the Gaussian, small or large. You see the difference. It just tells us how much detail to keep. Okay, I think let me show these in newer pictures like this from the textbook. The original image, this is thresholded gradient. Actually, it's really not bad. Don't go through all this trouble maybe, but this is, you see, very thick edges, not very nice localization. This is the Mar-Hildred, the old Mar-Hildred operator, Laplacian of Gaussian, that is, actually. And this is the Kenny. When actually Kenny came out, it created a big stir. Progress in the computer vision image processing field in 1980 or 81, because it was really very robustly extracting edges from images, and people got excited, said, oh, we can do a lot of things in computer vision using these edge maps. We can start doing template matching, object recognition, registration, correspondence matching, and things like that. So that's why it's a very, these are all very important developments in the computer vision field. Now, again, gradient magnitude thresholded. This is Mar-Hildred or Laplacian of Gaussian, or difference of Gaussian would give us the same or similar result. And this is the image obtained using Kenny. So you see, Kenny does this later edge linking step. You see LOG. It has here missing gaps here, right? The lines are not really continuous. But Kenny tries to really, tries to give continuous lines, which is very good, important for later processing, okay? These are further experiments with which play with these later parameters in the later steps of the algorithm. I won't be going through that. Compares the Sobel to Kenny for a noisy image. Again, Kenny is more robust. Of course, Sobel is just this, remember, 3x3 edge detector. Kenny does many advanced steps from non-maxima suppression to this hysteresis thresholding, which is really edge linking. So in summary, actually, this is the end of the edge detection. We've covered these derivative mask-based edge operators and gradient-based edge filters, plus the second-order derivative, actually, operators, of course. We have to be careful. We have to always include the smoothing before edge detection. So issue of how to choose threshold values, width of your mask, variance of sigma are all hyperparameter tuning, right? For an engineer, computer engineer, computer scientist, any engineer, these are hyperparameters to fix for your algorithms. I think that we've seen really a good deal of edge detection. I'm hoping now you have a solid understanding in the edge filter masks and the ideas in this edge detection. I think I kept some extra slides for the Kenny's later stages. You guys can just check them, but you are not responsible. So now this completes our learning objective for neighborhood operation-based spatial filters and also actually edge filters, which were actually helping us go into the feature extraction in a way. Now we will look at feature extraction, okay? All right, so now we will be continuing with a new topic, of course, a related topic, okay? Now, let me go to the slides here and see our learning objectives. We are in week 7 and we will be looking at feature extraction, which will include, or the goal will be to extract or towards detecting relevant information, desired, some desired information from images. For instance, half method will give us whether there are lines, whether we can detect lines from the image. We can detect circles, ellipses, corners. I think corners probably is going to be next week. So there will be template matching, which is also based on filters. But first, I want to motivate it, motivate feature extraction, why we need features. For instance, this is one of the most basic, I could say, applications in 3D vision. Of course, our course is not 3D vision, but feature extraction really also is an essential part of 3D vision, where we try to reconstruct 3D scene, or in this case, we try to use that 3D information to combine two images of the same scene, but the images are from different viewpoints, right? This is also called image stitching. How do we do this? How do we build? It's also called panorama, right? Panoramic images. We need to, for instance, I'm looking at this mountain image. I'm there walking. I'm a mountain climber. I take a picture, the first one, then I walk a little bit. I take the same scene, but from a different viewpoint. Now I want to align and fuse these images. Of course, you can't just put these two together because they are not in the same geometric space. They are not in the same coordinate space. Now you guys know this. Here, of course, you require projective geometry. But to do that, you won't be doing that here in this course, but at least you will know what pre-processing you need to go through. You need to detect the same features from the two images. Actually, this is called corresponding features or corresponding feature detection. So for instance, you extract a set of feature points from the two images separately, and you would have to really be able to match, for instance, the top of the mountain to the top of this largest hill. This is the second smaller hill here. You see these features don't have any correspondence on the left image, or these features on the left image don't have any correspondence on the right image. And there could be some corner-like or, again, important edge points where you can match here and there. And then detect feature points, find corresponding pairs. And then actually we use them to find a projective transform between the two. Actually, you guys did the affine version, right? You guys are somewhat experts. Projective is, remember, 1 degree higher, more general than the affine. And then once we estimate the projective geometry in between, now that's more includes more 3D effects you can see here. then we can bring, for instance, second image to the coordinate space of the first image to now be able to add them, fuse them or blend them together. That's one motivation. And what are feature points also useful for, like I said, 3D reconstruction? I'll just show a little bit more motivation, and that also ties to robot navigation, object recognition. We do indexing and retrieval, database retrieval with features, exactly like what I've shown, image alignment and panorama creation, motion tracking. We will study motion. Actually, we can use optical flow, this motion, apparent motion that you guys will learn how to estimate, and many more uses actually. So here is another motivation. Again, in 3D diffusion, one of our fundamental problems is how to recover 3D geometry of the scene. So given this image of this building or hut, let's say, what is its shape, or how do I construct actually 3D geometry? To do that, the classical 3D vision, what we do is we take pictures of the same scene from different viewpoints, and like I said, we, for instance, extract these corner points from the image, because I know it's a man-made object, a building, and this is the, but of course they have to be the same corner, the corner of the same window. Here, the top right corner of this window here, it has to be, if the picture views it, of course, if that camera views it, has to be extracted. And then output is, I will estimate camera pose, the camera calibration, and then once I have those, actually, I can always triangulate back and try to get a point cloud to be able to extract the 3D geometry. Okay, exactly. This is also called SLAM, structure localization and mapping. Again, I think this was, now I'm thinking, a lot of motivation for this course, a lot of 3D. But the point here is extraction of features from images is important. But another thing important is, of course, making those features correspond, like really finding the corresponding features is another matter. Lots of steps in going towards higher level processing. That's what I'm trying to show also, difficulty of vision. What we're doing in this class is really scratching the surface a little bit, but important parts, again, don't underestimate this course. It's a very important course to start data processing. Here, of course, it's mainly visual data. Okay, these are some more actually properties of the features and feature detectors. We would have to get repeatable detectors, meaning if I get extract the corner here, if it was a good corner detector, hopefully from another viewpoint it extracts the same corner, the top of the mountain, because otherwise there is no way to match these two irrelevant set of features, right? Then it's no use to extract these purple points and red points from or using this feature detector. And also it should be distinctive, because the second step will be, like I said, matching, right? So I should be able to have a feature descriptor where I know which of the feature points that I extracted in the second image really match to this given purple point on the left. So I need a distinctive descriptor, meaning descriptor of this point, for instance, or descriptive of this point should be different, and descriptive of this point should be similar to descriptor of this point, of the purple point, if you are following my mouse, of course. Okay. So now we go back, of course, from, you see, 60s, 70s, and 80s again. Last years we did not study SIFT, but let's see this year. You were not responsible. If the time permits, we can. Definitely not today, but this is the evolution of the feature detection. So we'll start with the half methods. But first, actually, before even these feature detectors, we'll look at the most basic feature detector, because we're coming from the filtering sections, right? The topics, right? We will first look at template matching for feature extraction, because it's really a simple filtering method where you have a template, and this is a very, very simple illustration of the idea. Let's say I have an image of an industrial object, a part like this, and I want to be able to see whether this nuts here, nuts and bolts, right, on top of it. So this nuts, I want to see if it exists in the image or not, okay? So template for a hexagonal nut, okay? So now that's a sub-image, right? Another motivation slide where, again, I have a picture of this person here, and I have an eye template. I want to maybe detect where the eyes are, or whether this feature, eye feature, or I may not even know what feature that is, but whether it exists in the image or not. What I want to do is create a filtering response where I have a high, actually, output at the place where this template exactly matches the region on the image where that feature exists, and gives smaller responses otherwise, okay? So we want to select point of maximal match as possible template location. So widely used similarity measure, I think you can think of a similarity measure. If I bring a template and I slide it over the image, you can actually view it. You will see that either a convolution or correlation, because it's exactly equivalent. Or you can say I can define a cost function like this through a similarity measure, sum of squared differences. So this F is, let's say, the image, T is the template. You slide the template, shift the template over the image, and look at this sum. Okay, sum of squared differences. M and size of the template, T. Okay, and if the image at point Y is, for an SSD, sum of square differences, of course, for a match, you have a zero response. But we actually, typically what we do is expand the expression and take, you see, you minimize the sum of square differences, or with this minus sign, you can see here, this is the correlation part, right? Cross correlation. I can maximize the correlation instead. Okay. Assuming T and F are not really giving me much information, because T is constant and F is actually discarded. So instead of a sum of square distance minimizing, we can do a maximization of correlation, cross correlation. And it is really maximized when portion of image under F, or image F under T, is identical to T. And this is really like convolution, we know. So template matching is really correlation of a template with an image. And it's, again, we know, is very similar to actually the not flipped version of the convolution, right? So of course, this is a very straightforward, simple question. If I have this template here, and if I have this image here, if I do a cross correlation, what would be the template matching response? Which one of these? I would have high response here, right? But I would also have some diffused, this actually spread response from here too. So it would be the result in two, right? So now, exactly, we've seen this in our filtering week. This is the same as convolution. T is shifted. But here, there is no flip on the sign of or the form of T, right? Convolution would require T minus X, T of minus X. So here is a question again. We've gone through this, but I can ask you again to make a point. If this was my template, I'm looking for this pattern, all ones, constant of ones, a constant pattern. And if this was my toy image, okay? And here, this is an asymmetric, by the way, filtering or correlation. Or maybe I should say not centered. Sorry, I shouldn't say asymmetric. It's a not centered operation. I thought about centering and said asymmetric. Not centered meaning I place this template here and you see I sum it up and I write 7 here. So I use the top left as the origin of the correlation, not the center. So the when you look at this correlation result, you see normally when it's placed exactly on top, for the top left, I get 7 response, right? I would expect the largest response at that point, but I'm getting 9 at the bottom right, because there is here an outlier number, an 8. Look at this pattern here, 1000008. This block, this sub-image, is really not similar to this template, right? But I'm getting a larger response. Why is that? Can you guess? Or can you tell me? Or how can I overcome that problem? Because normally when I place this template on this sub-image, I would really want this first response value to be the largest, right? Because that pattern is the most similar among all the sub-images in this image. That pattern on the top left, the first placement, gives me the largest response. Okay, the real problem is the normalization of this template, okay? You guys can again, I mean, this is again the same example. Again, I would want here, now it's the centered version. For instance, at A point, I would get 7, right? And at B, I would get 8. So again, but this is much closer to this pattern than this pattern. Now that brings me to normalized cross correlation. We need to really account for the fact that the local intensity variations, right, should be accounted for. So I should really subtract the mean locally at each point and divide by the standard deviation. So this is done for both the image and the template. Okay, so then this is called normalized cross correlation. Probably, again, you guys recall this maybe from an earlier class. And it also helps us makes us more robust to noise, like a bright spot, for instance, which can affect the correlation matching. And now you would calculate. I don't have the calculations because I would need to calculate the standard deviation of both here. But when you do the math, hopefully, actually, and I expect A will have a higher result, higher normalized cross-correlation result than B, okay? Probably we should put this down in the slide at some point, but you please do it as an exercise, okay? Now calculate the normalized cross-correlation values at A and B and compare them to non-normalized cross correlation at A and B, which were easy. This was 8, this was 7, and this was really not what we wanted. Okay. Now we said, okay, normalized cross correlation is a feature extractor where I can get a sub-image or a template and just slide it over my image. This is really like our convolution or filtering. Now our filter is this template in a way. And for instance, this A template, the image in A, can be found in B, let's say, if it was the same size, by the way. I'm giving you a hint. But there are problems here, right? C and D. What are they? The template could be in the image in a rotated way, or it could be scaled, right? So then we also have to take into account different rotations and scales of the template in feature extraction. I mean, this was some, this template matching was used a lot at some point in the past. Still, actually, even with deep learning, probably you guys realize we do a lot of similar things with filters, right? They are all based on these hierarchical, compositional, composed, multi-layer filters. So this is also hinting to the same idea. And remember, we also try to make those, even if they are learnable, we try to make them oriented to different orientations. The system, learning system, does it. Also, we try to support it from outside, right? by something called augmentation. There are advanced methods where people looked at like templates. From templates, they formed heat maps to be able to get rid of color variations, texture variations, all these appearance variations. Because there is, let's say, I'm trying to detect flowers in a given picture. And this is the actual flower pattern I'm after. It's a or it's a template I'm using, but I'm after any flower, let's say. My template has a yellow flower on a purple background with some texture. It has its own texture flower. And here this girl has a t-shirt where she has two flowers on the t-shirt. But you see with completely different colors, different texture, background is different texture. So you would have to this time create some maps, some features, maybe edge maps, heat map in this case, and try to match this time, do the template matching over those heat maps, for instance. Okay, and you can then overcome illumination and appearance variances. You can use edge-based or sketch-like features. For instance, here, there is a sketch template. You are after human figures which do this. On the left, you see the sketch template, right? So a body and two hands or arms up, wide open. You may be after that. So you may want to use then features, a template extractor or a filtering operator, which will actually create sketches from these images, right? So probably more edge-based feature processing. So in the end, these are the responses, by the way, right? Let me see. For instance, this is nicely detected. If you can do a sketch-based template matching, that's what I'm trying to say. Then you see here in this ballerinas, the one at the center is really exactly matching this template, but the others have a different arm configuration, so they are not matched. But it may not be working well in some cases if you didn't really design your filtering well. Maybe missing some, for instance, I see a problem here. This is from a paper, I think, from a past paper, this example. So it doesn't mean it's doing the, it's the ultimate solution. It's just one method which may be making errors. Okay. So this is these are some ideas on template matching, feature extraction using template matching. So let's start with half line detection. Now we go to more, again, basics, further basics, detecting lines through half transform. So we will be trying to fit lines, and also we may be wanting, we may want to detect endpoints of the lines, but I think for this course, we will be just, for now, due to time constraint, we will be just fitting the lines all over the image. You see, like here, for instance, for this pentagonal shape, we will be finding these five lines, okay? Or here we would find all these lines. How do we do that? By the way, why is it important? Because these lines are really very pervasive in our structures, surroundings, especially man-made humans actually built very geometric objects with straight lines in them, like our buildings. Okay, so we will be, remember, until today, we were like concentrating on low-level features like edges. Say I extracted edges from this image. But now I want to move a little bit further. I want to organize those edge points into straight lines, because then with those lines, I can try to do move towards higher-level understanding. I can try to understand or reconstruct the building. So I want to really detect these lines of windows here, the features on the building, both horizontal, vertical here. By chance, of course, they could be in other directions too. How can I do that? Or another motivation slide, again, to explain the problem. Let's say I have this nice road picture with lots of straight lines. But of, I mean, they may look curved due to our perspective geometry, and you see all the straight lines are. It's a great picture actually to show the perspectivity effect. These straight lines meeting at infinity, we say, in the end, due to the pinhole camera projection model. The here, but we, our goal is to, let's say, first extract edges. This is output of a Kenny edge detector at the bottom. This is the input image detector. Now I want to be able to say and detect edges and say whether there are straight lines, edges, because my goal would be, for instance, in this case, to detect the borders of the road and the lane line of the road, right? And you see, as it is, this edge map is useful, but I need to do more than that. So I need to be able to detect also the horizon line. Detection of the horizon line is important to understand structure. Now, what I do is I start with equation of a line, okay? Y is, of course, this is from high school, mx plus c, m is the slope, c is the bias or offset. Now, what we will do, here is the interesting thing, please pay attention. We are in xy space right here. We are in xy space. Now, we will go to the parameter space of this line, mc space. Okay, because in the xy space, I can say I have two points, x prime, y prime, x double prime, y double prime. I can say a line goes through them, right? Let's say it's this y prime, a line mc, a line with parameters m and c goes through these two points. Okay, so x prime, y prime satisfies this, and x double prime, y double prime satisfies this. Now go to the parameter space, mc. Now I can bring all the feature points, edge points. Let's say it's these two points actually that go through the same line, x prime, y prime, x double prime, y double prime. If I plot them onto this space, they will go through a single point, the same MC. If I extract a third point from this line, x3, y3 prime, that will also, when I map it onto the parameter space, it will also go through the same point actually. Okay? So what I'm trying to say here is I can populate this parameter space and in the end look at maxima of this parameter space, and then I can say, hey, this MC, this two parameter pair, it has really, it bears a line, includes a line that's coming from my image, because a lot of points support the hypothesis that there is an MC line or a line with a slope M and bias C through that line. Okay. So exactly this is, these are slides are trying to repeat what I'm saying. All such lines then actually, or actually all the points on the same line will be at the same point here. Okay. And that point will correspond to the line AB in my image space. Okay. So this would be the then algorithm, line detection algorithm. I want to quantize my parameter space with the appropriate max min values for C and M, form an accumulator array and initialize it to zero. Accumulator array in the parameter space, by the way. And then in my edge map, it could be from the gradient magnitude image or any edge map, I can bring the points, edge points, okay? And I can actually insert those into this equation, C equals minus mx plus y, okay? Insert all xy, detected edge points xy into this line equation this time, and I populate my accumulator array, CM array. Local maxima in the accumulator array will correspond to actually lines, okay? So it's a measure of course. I mean, it's it may have errors, but most likely, okay? One problem with this line equation, do you see it? There is a problem with this line equation. It may run into a problem at a special case with vertical lines in the image, right? There is a vertical line, slope of the line could become infinity. So instead, half method uses this other parameterization of a line. This is from, remember, geometry. I have a point x, y in the 2D space. This is valid for any Euclidean space dimension. And this cosine theta, sine theta, this is the actually normal vector to this line. And theta is the, actually, you see the angle of the normal to the origin here in this case. And rho is the distance to the origin of this line. Okay, so it's really xy dot producted with cosine theta sine theta vector, which is the normal to the line. They equal to the distance to the origin. Now parameterization is different. This is still a line. Now it's the rho theta parameter space. And here is the then idea. Now it's a rho theta space will contain, of course, sinusoidal curves. Okay, I move from xy space to rho theta space, meaning I discretize my rho theta space. Theta are angles, just because theta mean to theta max zero. So might be between minus pi over two to pi, for instance. And rho mean to rho max zero to some max possible line distance, maybe the diagonal of the image. Okay. And then I have to start populating. Let me see. Yeah, here is the algorithm. Start populating this grid. This is the idea. Start from actually here is the for loop. For each h point xy, this is the initialization. Initialize the A accumulator matrix to zero, or it's called P here. Or it's called P. For each edge point, go through your each edge point. You see now the edge detection we've done last week and first hour of this week is useful. We extracted edge points now. They are just a collection of edge points where our edge response filter gave large values, right? Large responses. Now, raster or iterate through the theta min to theta max. With some, of course, discrete intervals, and calculate rho, the distance, with line equation, and you have to round off, if, of course, to be able to insert this result into the accumulator array P rho theta, increment it. So it's really a voting. In the end, find local maxima. So here are some results. This is the original image. This is the parameter. So this was xy space. This is my rho theta space, guys. And you see the maxima. There are maxima here. I think also at the border, it's going to have a maxima. At this border. So for instance, we detected, let's say, three maxima. Probably this is also a maxima, but it's not shown here. But it's just detecting three maxima. So let's look at those lines in the image. You see where green, red, and blue lines are corresponding to those maxima. For instance, I'm missing the other side of the road. So probably, I'm not sure, but maybe it's coming from actually this second peak. Or it could be here. Maybe theta is a little bit different. You see, I got the horizon line, the lane line, one of the lane line, and one side of the road. Okay, here are some more examples. Again, the image, it's edge map extracted on top of the edge map. I do this half method, half algorithm, populate my parameter space accumulator array. Now detect the for instance, two maxima, I think they are marked here on this right, left and right. Those correspond to these two lines. This is the road. This is looks like a satellite image taken from a satellite. And you detect one of the lines. This looks like a road in some specific structure, maybe a airport lane or something. Okay. aerial image of an airport. Exactly. So this is one of the airport lanes.